thanks to our excavations, not just by our own team but other teams over the last 20 years, we've now established that Stonehenge was built in a series of different stages. First of all, shortly after 3000 BC, it begins with a bank and a ditch, but also upstanding features such as standing stones and timber posts. It's also at that moment that people started to use it as a cemetery. So this is somewhere around 3000 to 2920 BC, and it continued being used as a cemetery for at least 200 years and probably 500 years. It's then that the next stage of construction was put up, and that is these large sarsen stones. They're a type of sandstone. They come from the Marlborough Downs, about 20 miles away, whereas the smaller stones already in place had come from the Preseli Hills in West Wales, a distance of 180 miles. We started work about 10 years ago, and our initial emphasis was not on Stonehenge itself, but actually on a nearby henge called Darrington Walls, in fact the largest henge in the whole of Britain. It's about 17 hectares in extent. And what we established was that Stonehenge was just one part of this much larger complex linked by avenues to the River Avon. What we discovered at Darrington Walls were the houses of what must have been not just hundreds of people, but thousands of people. And it was there that we were able to work out that this was quite probably the workers' camp. One of our other major advances was to find out at what times of year people were actually inhabiting this village. Because although it's the largest known settlement from the Neolithic in northwestern Europe, it seems to have been occupied only seasonally. People coming in for particular times of the year, and we can track that by investigating the culling of the animals, because thanks to the way that their teeth grow, you can age them quite precisely to within months. So from spring birth, we were seeing that the majority were killed around 9 months later, and then the rest of them some 15 months from birth. So this really fixed the occupation of this large settlement to the winter time and the summer time. And of course, those are extremely important points within the Neolithic calendar at Stonehenge, because Stonehenge's main alignment is towards the midsummer sunrise and in the opposite direction, the midwinter sunset. What we're seeing is at least five constructional stages at Stonehenge, one shortly after 3000 BC, one around 2500, two small phases of rearranging the smaller stones in the next 300-400 years, and then a very last gasp somewhere around 1500-1600 BC. They dig holes apparently to move stones, but the stones are never moved. Whatever they planned never succeeded. There's last stages of construction also coincide with a fundamental social change in Britain, and that's the arrival of what we call the Beaker people. This is a continental style of ceramics and burial, but also an entirely new lifestyle. These are people that have been using metals, the wheel, and other innovations which have been absolutely absent from Britain for hundreds of years. So Britain was basically cut off from the continent up until the arrival of the Beaker people around 2400 BC. And I think it's their lifestyle, their politics, their social structure is so very different to the host culture within Britain. They are much more individualizing than the collective power structure within Britain. They also are not prepared to work en masse for just a few people. So the great monument building that's going on in Britain at this time, and it's not just Stonehenge, but many other timber circles, stone circles, earthen mounds of giant proportions like Silbury Hill, these come to an end within 2 centuries of Breton Arrival. They're coming from parts of Europe that don't have these kinds of traditions at all. They don't have these great gathering centres. It's a much more dispersed, decentralised social structure. And as it's adopted in Britain, so the whole rationale for these kinds of mega constructions simply disappears. We're starting to think of Stonehenge not as a temple where people come on pilgrimages and come to worship on a long-term basis. All our evidence suggests that it is used in a very punctuated form over time. People come, they construct, they feast, they go away. And this is really changing our notion of Neolithic religious belief, that it's all in the building rather than the idea of building something in order to do something with it, which is very much our 20th century take on the world. What we have at Darrington Walls, if we're right that this is the work camp, is that the houses show that we have entire household groups. So we're looking at men and women and children being involved in the whole thing. And they're feasting on cattle and on pig. They're barbecuing them, they're boiling them. And the huge concentration of resources shows that this is a very sophisticated infrastructure to support them. And by examining the isotopes for strontium in the teeth of our cattle, and we're now doing this for the pigs as well, we're finding out that the range that they're coming from has exceeded all of our expectations. This isn't just some local construction event for the people of the Chalklands of southern England. It's not even for the people of southern England and Wales. This is for people coming from the width and breadth of the whole island of Britain. So it's more than simply unnecessary food miles to bring those animals from all over the country. It has to be part of a very deliberate act of unifying and bringing people together.